In headlines, the Guyana Marriott Hotel fires approximately 40 Guyanese employees as it grapples with revenue loss as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. President Irfan Ali promises to put back money in people's pockets.
This week we'll be announcing a number of measures that will put back more money in people's pockets, that will create new opportunities.
Health Minister Dr. Frank Anthony says Guyana is still struggling with its backlog of COVID-19 tests. An indigenous youth is on a mission to teach language and culture, and in sport, Hetmyer among the runs as Warriors seal CPL semifinal spot. With the news, I'm Avinash Ramzan. Thanks for joining us. We started by telling you that the Guyana Marriott Hotel, in which retrenched employees have described as an overnight operation, fired approximately 40 Guyanese staff members earlier this week. Manager of the hotel, Eduardo Ripley, had initially agreed to an interview with the newsroom on Thursday, but later put his secretary to call an hour before the council, citing his unavailability. Details from Kurt Campbell.
The newsroom understands that the move to fire the employees was taken as the Guyana Marriott Hotel grapples with falling profits due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Employees were retained for months, working on a shift system rotation basis and for portions of their salaries. The now-fired Marriott staff said they had received repeated assurances from management that their jobs were secured. Several categories of employees were affected by the firing, including the front desk, the restaurant, banquet, housekeeping, finance, and it included several supervisors and managers. Speaking to the newsroom under strict anonymity, one senior staff member related that while Marriott has not done anything wrong to let them go, the manner in which it was done leaves much to be desired. Those who were dismissed said the news came as a shock since they were given no warning. The employees are also up in arms over the fact that only Guyanese staff were fired in the operation on the grounds that their jobs had become redundant while all the jobs given to the expats were secured. The newsroom understands that there are still four expat chefs employed by the Marriott with housing and other amenities paid for by the hotel. There are also claims of redundant management employees still being kept on staff, while the lower-level staff lost their jobs. The newsroom understands that the hotel is currently taking local bookings for the third floor, but ExxonMobil employees have taken up the second and all other floors of the hotel. The hotel was reportedly forced to cancel all special events booked at the venue for the remainder of this year and have been hit hard by the shortfall in persons booking rooms, visiting the restaurant, bar, and poolside as a result of the pandemic. Guyana's airports have been closed to incoming flights since March and still does not allow for foreigners or tourists to enter the country. Manager of the hotel, Eduardo Ripley, had initially agreed to an interview with the newsroom on Thursday, but later put his secretary to call an hour before to cancel, citing his unavailability. The newsroom again reached out to the hotel's head of human resource, Rafael Marcolan, and other senior management to comment on the issue, but this also proved futile. Kurt Campbell, Newsroom.
Meanwhile, the hotel's regional office subsequently informed the newsroom through its public relations department that it cannot comment on specifics of the issue, but emphasized that, quote, business levels have been profoundly impacted by the pandemic and continue to determine hotel operational and staffing adjustments, end quote. Days before the presentation of the 2020 emergency budget, President Irfan Ali has promised residents along the Soustdyke-Linden Highway that a range of measures will be announced to increase disposable income. The president on Wednesday visited the communities and met with residents, where he also noted that support will be announced for the forestry and mining sectors, which they depend on for their livelihood. Bibi Katoon reports.
President Irfan Ali on Wednesday visited several communities along the Soustdyke-Linden Highway, where he met with residents to address their concerns. The president said his government will ensure they get more money to provide for themselves and families.
By the end of this week, we'll be announcing a number of measures that will put back more money in people's pockets, that will create new opportunities. And we want to work here. In this community, you have a lot of young people. And we want to be able to reach out to the young people and work with the young people so that you can be part of the development agenda, so that we can help you to fulfill your own aspirations. That is important for us as a government.
The emergency 2020 budget will be presented next week. The president, accompanied by ministers of housing, local government, and foreign affairs, visited communities including Silver Hill, Kairuni, Lou Creek, Tiger Bowl, Banakari, Kuru College, and Swan. Aware that most residents find employment in the forestry and mining sectors, he said a number of incentives will be announced for those sectors.
Very shortly, we will announce a number of measures that will help back the community forest operators. You know, the forestry sector went down completely over the last 5 years. We now have to support the forestry sector, support the mining sector. I know in these communities you have many persons working in the trucking business, in the forestry business, in the lumber business, all right? And then you have your farmers. So these are things that we have to work on you with. I know your problems in relation to water and ownership and so on.
And light.
Of course, and light.
During the outreach, the government donated a total of 1,100 hampers to help those affected by COVID-19 and related restrictive measures. The relief efforts are extended to various communities across the country. Bibi Katun, Newsroom.
The Ministry of Education has formally advised parents, students, teachers, administrators and the general public that the national grades 2, 4 and 9 assessments for the academic year September 2019 to July 2020 will not be administered in the year 2020 or at all to the cohort of students who should have taken the assessment. The absence of these assessments will have no negative impact on the learners' records, the Ministry of Education noted in a very brief statement on Thursday. When the newsroom returns, Health Minister Dr. Frank Anthony says Guyana is still struggling with its backlog of COVID-19 tests, and Attorney General Anil Nandlal says Harmon's claim of oversized PPP government is outrageous. Stay tuned. Welcome back. This is the newsroom. The Ministry of Health is still grappling with a backlog of 1,000 COVID-19 samples collected for testing across the 10 administrative regions. Minister Dr. Frank Anthony explained that the number was reduced from 1,900 a few days ago. In the ministry's daily COVID-19 update, he said the 500 samples were sent to the Caribbean Public Health Agency for testing is expected on Friday, and as such, a big jump is expected in the number of positive COVID-19 cases.
We currently have a backlog of close to 1,000. That has been reduced from 1,900 a few days ago to now 1,000, but 1,000 is still quite a lot. So when we take a sample, it still takes a few days before we can actually get back the result. So we are working to decrease that time. And as an interim measure, what we have done, we have sent samples to CARFA. So last Monday, we sent 500 samples to CARFA, and we are expecting those results to come back either today or tomorrow. So once we get those results, I think, we would have cleared a substantial part of our backlog. But one of the things that people would have to understand when we get back those results, because there are 500 samples that went out, and therefore you might see a big jump in the numbers, and I don't want people to be alarmed. And so that's what we are trying to put in place right now, to have more machines, more people working. We have done training, but to set up these machines and to build that capacity, it requires some time. We are working with biohazardous material. So these are live viruses that can infect people if they don't take the precautions. One of the precautions that we have to put in place in the lab, we have to get a biohazard cabinet so that when we are extracting the samples, it's done under these sterile conditions and conditions that the person who is doing the extraction is not affected. Now, to set up these cabinets, we can set them up, but they have to be properly certified so that we know for sure that no viral particle can escape and infect the staff of the laboratory. So these things take a little time to set up. We have put the mechanisms in place to do that. We have acquired the cabinets. We are in the process of installing it. And we have contacted the agencies abroad who would have to come to Guyana to do the certification.
Now, just 1 month after coming to office, the People's Progressive Party government is faced with claims of extravagant government spending and an oversized cabinet by the opposition leader, Joseph Harmon. But the Attorney General and Minister of Legal Affairs, Anil Nandlal, has taken umbrage to the criticisms and has rejected them as being simply outrageous.
During the convening of the 12th Parliament on Tuesday, opposition leader Joseph Harman told the media that the APNU-AFC coalition was in receipt of information that the government had embarked on a route of extravagant spending, but warned that it will not be business as usual. He said the coalition intends to use its 31 seats in the National Assembly to ensure that the PPP accounts for all spending done during its first month in office and ahead of a national budget in place. Harman also lambasted the government for the size of its cabinet and the number of ministers and advisers it has appointed.
We are already aware of this pandemonium that has started in 1 month since this PPP came into government, and we will have them account for it. These include, but are not limited to, 20 ministries that the PPP has in relation to 15 that we have. Parliamentary secretaries are still to be appointed. Advisors, many of them, Jerry Gavaya, National Security, Lennox Schumann, the advisor to the Minister of Public Works on Civil Aviation, Ralph Ramkaran, to the Minister of Foreign Affairs on Border Issues, Carl Greenidge, advisor on border issues and on local content, Robert Prasad, Foreign Secretary, Sham Nakta, advisor on local content, Roger Luncheon, advisor of something, I don't know who is the advisor on right now. We will also ask them to account for this rapid economic investigation team, which was led by Christopher Ram and included Kate Nascimento and Nigel Hines. Who paid them? How much they were paid? What it is that they found? All of these are matters which we will raise on the floor of the National Assembly.
The opposition leader's comments did not sit well with Attorney General Anil Nandlal, who have since refuted the claims of excessive spending and a large cabinet.
Let us take the allegation of squandermania. We don't have a budget. We can't pay a salary. I just said that we had to rush to the parliament so that we can get money out of the treasury. All the agencies that were available to us outside of a parliamentary process, they have spent the money out. And this guy are accusing us, is accusing us of squandermania. We don't even have the money to squander, even if we want to squander. So that's the first ridiculous, outrageous statement he has made.
Nandlal said the allegations of squandermania are simply false. He clarified that the PPP government now has 17 ministries, while the previous APNU-AFC government, led by David Granger, had over 25 government ministers.
Then he accused us of an oversized government. We have 17 ministries. They just come out of government and they had 28. 10 more, 11 more than us. I don't understand this guy. And then you had 28 ministries and a whole host of ministers within a ministry. They took departments and made them into ministries. For example, the Ministry of Citizenship. That's the department now in the Ministry of Home Affairs with one minister. They had Kemraj Ramjetan and Felix dividing the ministry in two. So you have one set of staff for Ramjetan, one set of staff and secretariat for Felix, driver, bodyguard, house, telephone, all the things that the minister get, multiply by two, and he runs a department. Then you had about three ministers of Indigenous Affairs, Hastings, Garrido Lowe, and Mr.
Alicock.
You had four vice presidents.
Nandlal brushed aside the comments by Harman, saying that there was a need for the coalition to improve its public relations strategy and stop making unfounded and outrageous statements. Kurt Campbell, Newsroom.
As the fight persists against COVID-19, the Ministry of Health is now equipped with 29 new ventilators, 4,800 personal protective equipment, over 4,700 masks, 4,366 face shields, and a number of other medical supplies. The items were handed over to the Minister of Health, Dr. Frank Anthony, on Wednesday by the High Commissioner of India, Dr. K.J. Srinivasa, and also included 30,000 hydroxychloroquine tablets from the Government of India. Dr. Srinivasa explained that Guyana's proposal for assistance and collaboration for fighting the COVID-19 pandemic was processed under the India United Nations Development Fund. Minister Anthony noted that the medical supplies will be utilized by the Georgetown Public Hospital, which houses the COVID-19 intensive care unit. Dr. Anthony explained that while the hospital has competent doctors and nurses, they were providing care with limited resources. When the newsroom returns, an indigenous youth is on a mission to teach language and culture. This is the newsroom. Romario Hastings, an environmental officer by profession, is on a mission to teach others his indigenous language during the Indigenous Heritage Month. The 26-year-old is from the Akwayo tribe in Guyana and goes by the name Kapon, which is a collective identity in his tribe. He resides at Keiko in the Upper Mazaroni. The young indigenous leader on Thursday spoke with Newsroom's Bibi Katoon via Zoom, where he also explained why his people prefer the use of indigenous as opposed to Amerindian. He also shared his thoughts on the indigenous clothing worn by the Deputy Speaker Lennox Schumann to the National Assembly recently.
Well, Kapong is a cultural identity. So Kapong is how we basically relate to one another. And once I see you as another Kapong, you're basically seen as a relative. I am from Kako. It's a small Akwayo, Kapong, Akwayo community. It is one of about 11 villages that we have there today. I would have spent about 12 years of my childhood in there before I would have moved to the coast for schooling. It has played a key role in terms of the influence that it has on me now that I am becoming more self or culturally conscious, as I would say, because of course when you see something as unique, you would want to preserve it because it is not something you always find, right? When anybody speaks about cultural preservation, it's just not to say that we want to remain or stay as we are. That is quite impossible for all cultures. Everybody changes, everybody develops, but there are some essential elements that should be maintained, and I think that is where preservation comes in for me.
Can you tell me a little bit more about those essential elements that you think should be preserved as you see it into the future?
For me, first and foremost, language is a must. Language is very, very essential for a culture, and with the loss of a language, I think that is where culture would begin to really subside, to erode. In fact, for this heritage, I want to emphasize some key concepts that, of course, are in Akwayo. For example, today I was looking at Tunakwa, which means our water systems, and it could be rivers, it could be rain, and so forth. Tunakwa, right? And then you also have, for example, Padawang. Padawang, for example, is something that really says that you are from a specific area. We are the people from here. That's what Padawang means. So, for example, I can tell you that I'm Padawang from Upper Mazaroni. I'm basically saying that I'm a person that is rooted there, that I'm a person that belongs there, right?
As we celebrate Indigenous Heritage Month, two things I want to ask you in terms of current issues. One is with the Deputy Speaker dressing in his indigenous attire.
He is bringing to the forefront, to the mainstream, something that was literally non-existent to the Guyanese to the Guyanese society. So now seeing this in front of you, I think it triggers a lot of questions. I said, why now? It goes against convention, it goes against parliamentary tradition and all of these things. But I must acknowledge and I must applaud him for bringing indigenous presence in that manner, because I think otherwise we would just always be in the background. And I'm sure he's not gonna wear that every day because he wants to make that statement. And he wants to pronounce on the fact that indigenous people still have a presence there, and they can and they can be appointed within the governing structure of our country, and not only be a people that we must, that they must always cater for, because sometimes we are seen as being receptors of the government's care. On I think that is what it has seen as. Oh, indigenous people, we have to do this for them, this and that. But what can we do for our country as well? And I think that is where Mr. Schumann comes in.
Finally, for you, why indigenous instead of Amerindian?
You may say that, well, indigenous is also English. I mean, then what if it's not something that comes from indigenous people? But actually, it is a concept that involved the deliberation of global indigenous leaders as to how they want to be referred to within various institutions, legislations, and it also speaks to us having to identify ourselves differently from other cultures. And I think that is the distinction that speaks to me more as an indigenous person. What makes me indigenous, or why do I see myself as an indigenous person? Yes, we are the first people of the country, but although we are the first peoples of the country, we also have maintained that unique culture of ours. We have also maintained our connection to Guyana as a whole, and that is what resonates with me mostly.
We tell you now that Guyana's neighbor Brazil, recognizing that a new oil-producing country is poised for major transformational development in coming years, has committed once again to working with authorities here on major road, port, and energy projects. During a virtual briefing with Roraima Senator Chico Rodriguez on Tuesday, Brazil's Minister of Economy, Paulo Guedes, said the country wants to make the long-touted road from Boa Vista to Georgetown a reality. Senator Rodriguez is seen as one of the main defenders of the road in Brazilian Congress. As Senator Rodriguez explained, there is currently a great expectation that the road will be completed under President Jair Bolsonaro's government by promoting integration between Amazons, Roraimers, and the port of Georgetown. During the live broadcast, the Brazilian economy minister said that Guyana will be the new Dubai of the hemisphere and that Brazil will assist in the road, port, and energy collaboration. Guyana and Brazil have discussed constructing the road from Boa Vista to Georgetown for years, but nothing has yet materialized. The Guyana government had said in the past that it was seriously examining constructing a road from Manaus to Georgetown. The previous APNU AFC government had indicated that China is expected to fund the project. Guyana since signed on to the China's Belt and Road Initiative. 27-year-old Wayne Topcat Castillo was on Thursday remanded to prison on two firearm-related charges, along with discharging a loaded weapon at a police officer. Castillo of East Ranville, Georgetown, appeared before Magistrate Leron Daly at the Georgetown Magistrates Court, where he pleaded not guilty to the charges. The first two charges alleged that on August 27, 2020, at East Ranville, Georgetown, Castillo had in his possession one 9mm pistol together with six rounds of matching ammunition when he's not a licensed firearm holder. The last charge alleged that on the same day and location, Castillo discharged a firearm at police officer Kester Cosbert with intent to maim, disfigure, or cause him actual bodily harm. Castillo was remanded to prison until September 23, 2020, when he's expected to appear before City Magistrate Faith Magosti. After the break, the financial, weather, and bridge reports, along with sport. Stay tuned. Room now for a look at what's happening in sport. We start things off with some cricket news. After much deliberation, Hero CPL on Thursday morning confirmed the start time for next week's semi-finals and championship game at the Brian Lara Cricket Academy. Both semi-finals will take place on Tuesday, September 8, with the first one involving the first and fourth place teams starting at 10 a.m. Semi-final 2 featuring the second and third place teams will bowl off at 5:30 p.m. The final fixed for Thursday, September 10, will start at 10 a.m. There will be a reserve day available on Wednesday, September 9, in order to complete the semi-finals if required. Additionally, there will be 3 hours built into the schedule before overs start being lost in the final on Thursday, September 10, in the case of rain delays. Now, Shimron Hetmyer struck his third CPL half-century of the season, an unbeaten 56, to lead Guyana Amazon Warriors to a 7-wicket win over St. Lucia Zooks on Wednesday evening. The victory, their fifth in 9 games, secured the Warriors' spot in next week's semi-finals. Warriors knocked off the target of 110 in 13.5 overs, with Hetmyer leading the way and opener Chandapal Hemraj making 26. Earlier, Zooks were limited to 109 for 7, with Navinul Haq and Kimo Paul taking 2 wickets each. Hetmyer was named man of the match for his 50.
Well, Danny, it's been a long day at the cricket, but if that cricket didn't wake you up, nothing will. A brilliant 7-wicket victory by the Guyana Amazon Warriors, and the Indebet man of the match, none other than Shimron Hetmyer for his 56 off 36. Congratulations, Shimron. First question. Low totals have been giving batsmen and teams trouble in this competition. 92 was defended not long ago. What was the discussion in the team room before coming out?
Well, actually, we just had a, Puran basically said for us to just go out and be positive and just express ourselves and play our natural game. And I think that really worked for us today.
Boy, did it work. Beautiful stroke lay all over the ground. Shimron, a joy to watch. Tell us about that form.
It's coming back. I thought I lost it a few games ago, but I'm working on it and I'm trying to stay a little bit more focused on my game and how to start an innings and how to build and how to finish an innings as well.
You were brutal on Shamar Holder, your friend.
Yes, I think it's a trend with me to basically take apart my good friends. But at the end of the day, it's cricket, and off the field, we're still good friends.
Yeah, you said something to him when you were leaving.
Yeah, even after the game, I spoke to him, and he said he was trying to get the short balls across me. But I just told him that he could just try to get it the length better than the pace.
Better luck next time, mate.
Yeah.
Three back-to-back wins for the Guyana Amazon Warriors. Is your team back in some form now?
Yes, I think so. The guys are really and truly starting to work harder than before and starting to believe in ourselves a little bit more each and every day. And from here on out, I think it's just taking it one game at a time.
Well, Shimron, I know that West Indians around the globe would have enjoyed watching you in that form and watching that knock, but the Warriors fans, how about a word for them before we go?
Keep supporting us, guys. I have my wife home as well, my biggest supporter. She's also a Warriors fan. So keep supporting us, and hopefully we bring it home for you this year.
Shimron Hetmyer, it was a joy to watch. Congratulations. The Indebet man of the match.
Meanwhile, Captain Chris Green is pleased with the level of consistency put up by the Warriors during the last three games. They have won on the trot. What is most pleasing to the skipper is different players are taking responsibility every game.
Congratulations, first of all. That bowling performance, how pleasing was it yet again from the Amazon Warriors?
Yeah, another solid bowling performance. You know, we've been really consistent with the ball, mixing it around with both seam and spin, putting the hands up at different times. And that's, you know, been really impressive for me. It's been different guys. It hasn't been one or two bowlers. It's been different guys every game. You know, the guys that have come in and out of the team, they've really put their hand up, taken the challenge on to bowl up front, through the middle and the back end. And I think that's putting us in a good position in all our games to be successful.
And when you guys play like this, you look like such a dangerous unit. The challenge is to do this consistently, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. You know, at the start of the tournament, we were a bit inconsistent with the bat. We were asking constantly for that long partnership. Our last three games, where we've been really successful, we've built that partnership. We haven't lost multiple wickets, and that's been our key recipe for success, rather. And, you know, our top batters are putting their hands up and getting the job done for us. And again, it's different guys each game, so that's really happy for me.
And talking about your top batters, are we on Shimron Hetmyer tonight?
Yeah, you know, you can't keep class down. Same as Brandon King last night. Hetty hasn't really failed. He started the tournament well. He never really got in after that. He's getting out early, and he sets a high bar for himself. So, you know, he always wanted to get better, wanted to contribute to this team. Tonight he stood up and gave us that performance. So, you know, as Dan said, we've also now ticked that little box of qualifying, but it's not over yet. We've got to continue to build into tomorrow. We've got Barbados. We've got an opportunity to knock them out of the competition. And then we put our eyes onto whoever we play on Tuesday.
Yeah, one objective done, Chris. All the best.
And the Guyana Amazon Warriors opener Brandon King said that the 2020 tournament has been tough for batting compared to 2019 when he topped the run chart. After a lean start, the Jamaican right-hander returned to form with a match-winning 51 against Barbados Trident.
Well, he was one of the marvels of the 2019 CPL, has had a tough 2020 season so far. 7 games where he couldn't get a start until a marvel of a half century last game. Brandon King, let's talk about that. Let's talk about what it takes for a player to find back form after failing consecutively.
Yeah, naturally I was disappointed, you know, not getting the start that I wanted, but I was never discouraged from, you know, doing my job for the team, and I always maintained belief in my ability, and my teammates also, you know, reinforced that belief in me. And I think it's important not to carry any negative thoughts from previous games. I think that would make it harder for you to, you know, succeed. So that's what I try to do.
Well, I'm sure the Warriors fans are thrilled about that. You know, it's interesting to know how you'd have done that, particularly when the guys around you were also not firing. We recently saw, well, we saw him, Shimron Hetmai, at the beginning of the tournament, and then we saw Nicholas Pooran. But there were their guys dropping around you as well. How did you maintain your belief?
Yeah, I mean, it's, as a professional, you have to. You know, this is how you move from strength to strength. And as I said, our team is very much a family, and we believe in each other 100%, and we never doubt each other's ability for at any moment. So that was really crucial to it. I think we recognize this year it's a little bit different, you know, the conditions and are a bit challenging, so that's all it is.
Well, this year is a bit different. Much has been spoken about your season last year and how you had a perfect run. A very different season this year. Does it give you a good feeling?
Yeah, it's definitely different this year so far. I think it's fair to say that it's more challenging for batsmen this year. We see a lot of low scores in the games, and it's just about us adapting to it. Last year we had such a consistent run up until the final. This year a little bit different, so we're just hoping that, you know, we're catching momentum at the right time, you know, in the business end of the tournament.
All right, an unusual position for you guys. You're trailing the St. Lucia Zooks in the table. What do you do to beat them tonight?
All the games have been relatively close, so we know it's just a matter of doing the right things at key moments during the game, you know, being consistent throughout and staying positive.
All right, go well. Thanks, Brent.
Thank you very much.
And Jamaica Tallawas and St. Kitts and Nevis Patriots had to settle for a split of the points on Thursday morning as heavy rain forced no result in their contest at the Brian Lara Cricket Academy. Only 5.4 overs were possible, by which time Patriots raced to 46 without loss. Heavy rain forced the players off the field, which was subsequently waterlogged. The game was officially called off at 1:15 p.m. Tallawas moved up to 7 points in fourth position, and Patriots moved to 3 at the bottom of the table. Finally, CONCACAF has announced an exciting new format for the 2021 edition of the CONCACAF Gold Cup and the introduction of a first-ever draw for the prestigious regional tournament. More in this report.
The new setup for CONCACAF's flagship competition will include a preliminary round prior to the 16-team group stage. The preliminary round will include 12 member associations competing for the final 3 spots in the group stage. It will be played as a direct elimination format from July 2 to July 6, 2021 in a centralized location in the United States. Additionally, a major change to the knockout phase, which follows the group stage, will see teams on opposite sides of the bracket meet from the quarterfinals onwards. In previous Gold Cups, teams have only competed against opponents on the same side of the bracket until the final. This change will provide more unpredictability and excitement to the competition, which was expanded from 12 to 16 teams for a hugely successful 2019 edition. As part of the Confederation's focus on continuing to deliver a football-first philosophy and to add more anticipation for fans across the region, a first-ever Gold Cup draw will take place on September 28, 2020. Both the preliminary round and the group stage will be drawn at the event, further details for which will follow in the coming weeks. The preliminary round will comprise the 12 national teams who qualified through their CONCACAF Nations League performances, including the third-placed teams from League A groups, the second-placed teams from League B groups, and the winners of League C groups. Those teams are Bahamas, Barbados, Bermuda, Cuba, French Guiana, Guadeloupe, Guatemala, Guyana, Haiti, Montserrat, St. Vincent and the Grenadines, and Trinidad and Tobago. After a knockout format involving the 12 national teams, the remaining 3 teams at the end of the preliminary round will qualify for the Gold Cup group stage.
And with that, we've come to the end of the news for this evening. Of course, you can find updates on these and other stories on our website, newsroom.gy, our Facebook page and Instagram. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Afanash Ramzan. Thanks for watching. Be safe. See you next time.